And we're now joined by political analyst Edwin Tayao. Good morning, Edwin. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning.
All right, Edmund, let's talk about the Duterte family positioning themselves as the opposition. What do you make out of this political move?
I'm not sure really whether the pronouncement made in Cebu, if you're referring to the Cebu rally, whether that says that they've categorically mentioned that they will be opposition. No? The messages there were quite mixed, to be honest. No? Even the mayor was saying that the gathering was not necessarily against President Bongbong Marcos. No? So I'm not yet sure. In fact, if I am to interpret, no? It's difficult really, no, to make sense of the moves of the former president. It seems that it's very, to say the least, it's very political, no? So sa Tagalog, naninimbang or kumbaga, it's still a very tentative political position. So if we assume that they will be the opposition, of course that's quite expected, no? I mean that there will be groups that would likely be interested to vie for positions of being a senator on this coming midterm election. Nangyayari naman yan every midterm election. But the one that categorically declared that they will be the opposition slate is, of course, as expected, those that are identified, no, with the Liberal Party, no, that has found you know, significant difficulties getting back to power during the past administration.
All right, Edmund, before we talk about the Liberal Party, let's first dissect the statements and the moves of the Duterte family. The former president, as we all know, called the current president as a user of illegal drugs. He called him a drug addict at that. His son, Davao City Mayor Basté Duterte, in that Cebu rally, gave a lengthy speech lambasting President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. It was delivered, though, in Visayan, in the dialect of the Visayans. But our regional correspondent tells us that it translates to something like the younger Duterte calling out President Marcos for not speaking out on issues, and he even challenges the president to give out relief goods without his name or his face. He also says that the funny thing about this administration is that people liked it for its promise to deliver 20 pesos per kilo of rice, and yet he called that a scam. Now, it's quite clear to me that those are strongly worded statements against the current administration. Add to that, Vice President Sara Duterte, for the first time, released a message on the commemoration of the EDSA People Power anniversary. The first time she did that since 2022. Is that actually, would it be accurate to say that that is a move that the Duterte family is somehow already drawing the line ahead of the 2025 midterm elections?
Well, thank you for that clarification. I still stand with my interpretation. That's your interpretation, and that's quite welcome. But the young Duterte was also interviewed. What's the purpose of the gathering? And he was also quoted as saying that this is not against the current president, not against President Bongbong Marcos, but against the government, against the administration. Kaya nga sabi ko kanina, naninimbang. Kasi it seems that while they're very categorical and they're very emotional, in fact, no, very strongly worded words, worded speeches, no, against the president, still, when they ask, when they're asked, what's the purpose, ang sinasabi nila, it's against the government. So kaya sabi ko, tentative. No? Mm-hmm. Ngayon, yung nasabi mo kay Vice President, in fact, I'm quite surprised that suddenly, no, they will be participating in the commemoration of the EDSA People Power. No? There's no need for interpretation there. I'm just quite wondering because, of course, we know already what happened in the past administration during his during her father's term of office, no, that precisely the EDSA the commemoration no, has always taken the backseat, to say the least. No? So again, it's quite tentative in the sense that this time around, no, they see the need to become willing partners to political groups, no? So including not the political group that they used to criticize. So ganyan naman sa politika pa bago-bago. Ngayon, kung i-insist natin na categorical, that depends on particular interpretations, no? Kasi sa akin mixed signals pa din. Perhaps if there will be a slate that will be outlined or introduced later, then we can very well say that ito meron talaga silang opposition slate.
All right, that's quite interesting also because former President Rodrigo Duterte's allies in the Senate are set to finish their first terms as Senator Ronald De La Rosa, Senator Bongo, Senator Francis Tolentino. So we have a wait and see kind of situation on whether or not they will be included in the slate of the administration or whether or not they will field their own set of candidates. What are your sources telling you on the ground, Edmund?
Thank you for pointing that out. No? That's why precisely I'm saying it's quite tentative. We've seen the pronouncements of sitting senators, no, and especially Senator Bato de la Rosa. No? He contradicted what the former president said as far as President BBM's being included in the PIDEA list. No? So again, unless there's already a pronouncement that, hey, this is the slate for this political group, I don't call them political parties because we don't have real political parties. No? Until such time that we change the current setup, we don't have a real political system to speak of other than political personalities. No? So as such, I have yet to see really, no, whether there will be a categorical pronouncement made. Now, again, the same goes with the other group, the Liberal Party. They included the former Dean of College of Law, Chel Jokno, no, and forgot the other one. But they're not officially members of the Liberal Party just yet. So again, it emphasizes that at the end of the day, it depends on how a political group is finally given its final shape and offered to the introduced to the public.
Mm-hmm. Shell, speaking of the Liberal Party and other opposition groups, how is this situation, how advantageous is the situation actually for them? Because on one hand, you have a looming implosion within the supermajority, and on the other hand, you have the Duterte family seemingly wanting to take the spot of or the role of the opposition under this administration.
Hindi ko pa nakikita yung mga surveys, no, yung mga legitimate na surveys. That's why I requested your staff to introduce me as a member of the Political Economic Elemental Researchers and Strategists because you've seen in the news that there are some to say the least, questions not to new quote-unquote survey organizations that's been coming out. Now, in other words, I don't have the numbers with me just yet to say which group. And again, we don't have any group that has been declared just yet that is officially a group, no? A usable, no? I don't want to say reliable interpretation, no? As to who or which political group will have a good chance. Now, of course, as you've mentioned, there's a vacuum that is to be filled, which is the position of the opposition party, or the opposition group for that matter. Again, this has been true to all past administrations because the kind of setup that we have, the kind of political setup, is that everyone seemed to gravitate towards the sitting administration. No, so until such time that the sitting administration, the president, most especially, if and when there is really a mistake that is categorically rejected by many people, that's the only time that we can see a beeline really of people going to the other side. Also, we have to take note that we've seen this in the case of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. No, but even with the opposition winning, no, the majority in the in both houses of Congress, no, in the during her midterm election, in the end, no, she still managed to get majority support. So again, it's really the political setup that we have that we can hardly say that there is an opposition, a legitimate opposition party.
All right, shifting to a slightly different topic, Edmund, you mentioned about new survey groups coming ahead of the 2025 midterm elections. What are the red flags? We all know that these groups can be somehow weaponized by certain politicians to make it seem that they are ahead in terms of the surveys. What are the red flags for you to say that a group or another is quite questionable?
Well, of course, the methodology that that has been pointed out by the statement of UP, I think that's the School of Statistics, no? Also, we've seen that in all previous elections. No? I remember the past election, for example, no, using Google, no, as a measure of popular support. But then of course, we don't have to belabor the distinction between actual survey that's being done and Google metrics, no, because you know when you talk about Google metrics, you're measuring the mention of a name, and the mention of a name is not necessarily always positive. It could be negative, no. So that means it can't really be considered an alternative measure of popular support. And so, in other words, unless a group is able to really explain clearly that the methodology followed and the way the questionnaires, the way the questions are formulated. Excuse me. The way the questions are formulated, no, clearly objective, or at least there's a painstaking effort to make it objective, and therefore not leading a question, then I'm inclined to think that it's a legitimate survey.
Mm-hmm. But the worry here is that it's so easy to claim that you conducted a research involving X number of respondents in areas Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao with the demographics XYZ. How can the public actually verify or guarantee that these are legitimate surveys that were done?
When a survey company comes out, no, we can't say right away that it's that the results and the methodology is legitimate. We can just see it after some time, especially when the elections already happen, and find out that the purported results of the survey that they came up with differed drastically from the actual results. Then we know already, no, that that is not a legitimate survey. It's really difficult to say because we need to see some track record. Second, of course, you have to find out who are the people behind, no, the group doing this purported surveys. I'm sure, of course, that, for example, as an academic myself, it would be difficult to lend my name, no, to a group that I know for sure, no, would not follow the rigors of actual social science research. No? And third, of course, as I've mentioned, you have to look look into the fine detail of how the surveys were conducted. Yeah, you're right in saying that it's very easy that this were conducted across this and so on and so forth. But when the one explaining it is not a trained statistician, you can very well see the red flags when he or she tries to explain how they conducted the survey.
Mm-hmm. Maybe also helpful to remind the public that they should not rely on surveys alone before casting their ballots or choosing their candidates for the upcoming polls.
Well, wala pang research na ginawa dyan, no? But I'm inclined to think that the voting public have know that they are not to be swayed, no, with the results of the surveys. We've seen this a number of times. In fact, if I remember it right, sometime 2013 midterm election, no, all the survey companies was this predicted. Not that Senator Grace Poe would be landing between number 8 to 12, because that's supposedly the ranking that came out in the survey. No, but the actual result had her as the number one senator, no, in the winning slot. So also in the previous election, I think they were expecting, no. I forgot the results of the surveys, no, but they weren't expecting Senator Rafi Tulfo, no, if I'm not mistaken, who emerged as the number one senator in the previous election. So, especially in a multi-member district, no, that's the term that you use when you vote more than one candidate, no, in a single position, because we always vote for 12 senators, so you call it a multi-member district. When you vote in that, when you vote for candidates in that particular case, it's really difficult to determine, no, the ranking, and it can very well show that the voters really do not just follow the results of the survey.
All right, and we will have to leave it at that for now. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, political analyst and member of the Political Economic Elemental Research and Strategists, Edwin Tayo.
Thank you. Thank you so much.